box.
Okay.
All right. So we're going to get started this morning and just welcome everybody that joined us. I'm going to introduce Erica. So Erica Thiel is she's a program specialist in Idaho, and she's the 4-H online guru, pretty much in the West now. So I'm going to turn it over to her.
All right. Thanks, Carrie. So I don't know, the one thing I found with 4-H online, it makes sense, but you have to use it. And so I can talk about the program and I can show you different things, but don't be afraid to utilize the system, I guess, is my first and foremost thing that I want you guys to take away from this and that, and there's no such thing as a bad question. It's intimidating, you know, it is a lot. There's a lot of different things that you can do within 4-H online. But I think once you get used to kind of where everything is in the system and kind of orient it to what works best for you, it's a great system. As much as I'd like to say that we're at 5 years into this almost, that we're, you know, 100%, you know, everybody's on board. No, part of the things that we've run into, different counties in Idaho selected different ways of rolling out the use of 4-H online to their families. For the counties that opted to just have their families get into the system and utilize it, that by far and away has provided a more positive experience for everybody involved. And there are several factors to that. I think that it gets the families into the system. The families are aware that, okay, this is where we need to go. They're not having to fix something or enter into a system that's already been created. And I realize and totally understand the wanting or the need for some folks where you would need to have your enrollments in the system through a paper-based piece, but wherever it is possible to encourage families to utilize the system, by all means do so. There's a few things that you can do to help promote the use and having families do that if they don't have internet access at home. Some of our county offices have office space or have a permanent place in the community and have pretty much an open door policy where families want to come in during office hours to utilize or do something on their 4-H online, they're welcome to do that. And the libraries, amazingly, have been very generous across the state in terms of allowing access to 4-H online. Some counties vary in terms of their firewall clearance, but it works out very well. Families utilize libraries a lot, and so that's just kind of their routine when they come into town. So there are options to work around that if families don't have internet access at home. If families have computer access, they're accessing that technology at home, then there's no reason why they can't do 4-H online at home. And I think part of the main reason why that works and why that is successful is that the families take ownership of that. They get comfortable utilizing the system. And the nice thing about that, if you can move towards that as a goal, is it takes you out of data management. Yes, we still have to manage our data. We still have to monitor things. But as far as what we used to do, it's really evolved. As far as some of the big options, big things that you can do in 4-H online, obviously enrollments. As you move forward with different options in 4-H online, there's more features available in the universal license. Some of those things, and I should mention, with the basic enrollment package, you can do broadcast emails right now. You can do newsletters. So That's another area where you can look at saving some money, A, and encouraging use of the system, B. You can post your newsletters in the system, and basically all that information stays right there. So all the families will see that when they log in, and I can show you here a little bit where you would see that. The other benefit too is you can then kind of, you know, determine, okay, families are accessing the system. They can indicate what their primary correspondence preference is, whether it's mail or email, then that's going to be a cost savings to you guys. The broadcast emails give you a method or a mechanism to communicate with everybody in the system without having to try to copy and paste and create a distribution list in Outlook or whatever email platform you use. I have found that with the newer versions of Outlook, creating a massive distribution list for plus of 200 doesn't happen. They don't like that anymore. So this gives you an opportunity, A, create a massive distribution list, send it out. B, you can monitor the emails that are sent, opened, or dropped. So drop gives you an indicator of bad email addresses. And it's all contingent on valid working email addresses. People are really bad about having, or they forget about what they have, and that's fine. We can modify email addresses and reset passwords. It takes a couple of clicks. It's not an end of the world. It gets a little problematic when they create duplicate records. And that was one of the biggest things that we've had to do year five, or almost five into the system, is for families that started out with paper-based enrollments and now have transitioned to opening the system up to their families. There's a lot of duplicates going on as far as duplicate accounts, duplicate member records. Some of those can be cleaned up, some can't. It just kind of depends on a case-by-case scenario. And those are some things that, you know, you can clean up on your side. Some things, for the most part, have to be cleared up on my end. So how you can clean it up on your end is making sure you do not only a member volunteer search, but search for the family, check that email and that mailing address, just to make sure that there isn't an account or something in the system that already exists. If there is, don't create the new record. Or if they're pending, you can delete it at that point. Once it gets accepted, then that's where it gets tricky, and I have to work on trying to merge those records. Sometimes that can work. Sometimes I have to wait a while. The system recognizes our 4-H year. So right now we're 15, 16, and we'll be going into 16, 17. And so let's say we had somebody in the system. They created a duplicate record. Let's say we're already in the new 4-H year. Well, system recognizes an overlap in 4-H years, and that's something I can't fix. But what that means is I have to wait until we get further down the trail to 17, 18 to be able to merge those records. And I found that for the most part, I can merge, but there are times where I just simply have to archive those records and I can't merge them. Some things that kind of, those are things you have to learn along the way, but it's okay, and we kind of work through that. But on the universal license, I'm not sure if animal identification is a big button issue for you guys as far as people being ethical and identifying the appropriate animals, or no ear tag swapping, but there's a very robust animal identification component. It does take a little bit of time to set up, but it's definitely worth that. You get visual identifications of your animals. If you have some paper version of a horse identification record, it pretty much eliminates the need for that, because you're getting all your pictures of your brands, white markings, the whole nine yards. Very beneficial for livestock, especially if you have a state fair or larger fairs. It gives you an animal you get the visual, you get ear tag information, and all the pertinent things that you need. Iowa and Texas go so far as adding in components where you do your DNA and retinal scans. So the platform is there to make it as robust as it needs to be as far as how you identify animals. That there's been a lot of time spent on that. You also get some added information as far as health forms. There's different elements being developed as far as tracking volunteer training. And I guess what I can do is I can get into the system here and show you just kind of some of the basic components, just to give you a lay of the land. And my computer, there we go. Where you can find different things. And then I might have to jump over to Idaho. So then that way you can see some of these different things to think about. Now, Carrie, for this next 4-H year, are you guys just going to do basic enrollment?
Yes.
Okay. Well, then we don't have to worry about that.
Yeah. It would be great if you could show them the animal ID. I know that we've got several counties on here that do have a pretty large livestock component. And so they can't, you know, and I don't think we're utilizing that. I don't know if it's even turned on.
Okay. Well, and if you only have the enrollment license, which it kind of looks like that might be the case, you don't have the animals tab.
We're supposed to for some, okay.
It may be in test mode or demo mode. And if that is, then just let James or Celeste know and they can. But the biggest thing, since we're very close to rolling over to a new 4-H year, for programming that you've done for this year, outside of what you would have in your traditional club pieces, like if you did any day camps, that type of thing, you can do a group enrollment form. And so this provides you a way of tracking those contacts and those, it's a way of reporting your outreach within your community. This information uploads to USDA NIFA. It's a pretty simple process. I do have a group enrollment form we can modify for you guys, but and it pretty much follows the screen. It's a 3-step process. 4-H members that are traditional members, maybe they engage with you in different delivery areas and different programming. Those are considered duplicates, but we still do them or count them on initial headcount. But all of these fields here are required. You enter in your program name, your different type. Right here you have a drop-down menu of your different delivery modes. You enter in your contact hours. You do have to link a project. So you do have broader project categories. So you need to be able to make some sort of tie to the project. Okay. We'll just do add project. We'll do ambassadors. And I hope I don't have to, just for the sake of demonstrating. So you enter in your program information, where it was at, those types of pieces. You remember on my group enrollment form, I also have a sign-in sheet, because a lot of times we'll get these folks, and that was probably one of the hardest pieces I always had to remember when I worked in the county, is I was great about getting the programs, but when it came time to doing the reporting piece on this, I'd play heck trying to remember, okay, what was my numbers of males and females? What grade are they in? Are they 4-H members or not? So this pretty much takes out all of the guesswork out of this. But your total headcount, your distribution, and your gender, this includes all of your duplicates and then your basically what is considered new. And those numbers, with the duplicate removed, this number has to match the remaining numbers on your for your member reporting. So basically, you're capturing the gender, you're capturing your racial distribution, residence, and grade. Again, all of those numbers have to match. It takes, you know, if you have the paper form, you can walk right through that, but it's better to enter in as you've done your programming versus doing it all at the end. But once you've gotten your member, the distributions recorded, then we also have the volunteer distribution. If you have adult and or youth volunteers, new volunteers only that are engaged in the program. If you did not have any new adult or youth volunteers, then you're pretty much done. Check the box to say submit form, click save, and it's pretty much done. Nice thing about 4-H Online, when it comes time to process the ES-237s, it's done automatically. The caveat is you need to make sure your data is in the system. There is a little bit of massaging that can happen after rollover, but that's not the preference. The goal is to try to have all of your reporting done before rollover, which, are you guys on the September 30th, Carrie?
Yes, we are.
Okay. So you want to make sure if you have programs to report, and I realize we're in September already, but if you do have programs where you've done day camps, live, you know, different outreach type things with different delivery methods, even school enrichment stuff, get your data entered into the system between now and, if at all possible, before that last week of September. That way Carrie can kind of double check things and I can help her with that. That's a pretty important piece, especially if you're doing any Eat Smart initiatives, any, you know, statewide outreach or things where you're definitely going to have some impact. You've got numbers to report. That's very important for us to do that.
I'm just going to jump in. If you have anybody within your office that's doing any kind of youth programs, we need to remember that this is the extension youth report. It may say 4-H ES-237, but it is our extension youth report. So try to get those numbers from those individuals. So when she said the Eat Smarter, the SNAP Ed, if they did youth programs, then we need to try to get those that data from them as much as possible.
And I realize that's easier said than done. We do need those numbers, though. It's just so helpful to have that information entered in the system versus having to try to round that up after the fact. It takes a lot of time. So like Carrie said, if you have somebody that's doing outreach programming with youth, regardless of what the area is, those numbers need to get reported in this system. Another big piece for you guys, you probably have wrapped up with fairs. You're getting very close if you haven't done so already. But we can capture project completion in 4-H Online. So off of the enrollment tab, we just click projects, and from your drop-down list, you have all of your different projects. So for, let's find a, cake decorating. Okay, how about market beef? So for your 4-H projects, you'll want to go through your premium lists or whatever you do for your livestock projects in terms of, you know, checking off the record books if you check record books or whatever you use for your piece for your livestock projects, and then also your static projects. You should have a good idea by now who has or has not completed their project. Now, if you have an evaluation or a public display piece that hasn't quite occurred, maybe that's happening in a couple weeks, then that's okay. You still have time. But for your other projects, you want to go through all of your projects and mark your project completion. And this is very simple. If you know that Helen has completed her Market Steer project, you can add, simply since she's the only one in here, you can add the check mark yourself for projects where perhaps you have a lot significant. You have the option to check all. So if you have a massive amount of people, you know, maybe here and there, there's probably a couple, check them all, and then you can uncheck selectively who has or has not. But once you've checked who has completed the project, then you just go to project completion options and click project completion, and then you're done.
There's a couple of comments and questions in the chat box.
Oh, okay. Let's see. Okay.
So I'm gonna help with Jasmine's question. So Jasmine just started like a week and a half ago.
Okay.
So what we need to do, yes and no, Jasmine, what we need to do is there's about five people that are brand new, have never used 4-H online. So we need to set up some time with Erica that she can show you how to get that data entered. So when they enroll or when you're adding in their information, that's when you add in the projects.
Yeah.
So.
Yes. Thank you for that. So yes, the member records need to be in the system, and we can work on getting together here soon, hopefully, to get that taken care of. Then once we get that done, then we can go into this part. A big piece before you get to the enrollment part is making sure that your clubs have been set up and you've got your projects in there. And if you have any county-based projects, that's where the project aliases come from. Big piece with projects before you get into keying your enrollments is linking your projects to your clubs. And the reason for that is, so when you enter in a member record, obviously they're going to select what club they're in. But for the project to selection to work, the linking of the projects is a big deal. And it's also a big deal once we roll over, in Idaho, October 1 has a lot of impact. It's new year, but that's also where we're going to see at the state level if we've added any new projects. So if you get a report from the state level, okay, these are the new projects offered this year, or it may very well be no changes, that's great. But if there are changes to your projects, specifically new state level projects, and you know that the club, XYZ club, is going to offer those, you have to link those projects to a club. Once you have done your initial setup, and I should clarify that, once you've done your initial setup of your club, and this is probably just a beef, so they're not going to take and only thing that they should have selected is B. They don't, but if you know a project is, a new project is going to be offered, you have to check that box. Once you do the setup of your club, none of this will change at rollover. It stays put the way you've left it. So if you know a club only offers four projects, you don't have to worry about that changing at rollover. The only caveat is if there's something offered new at the state level, you know that club is going to offer, you have to check that box.
And currently the counties select their, what projects they offer. We don't really do a lot at the state level, but if a new project comes out from the national, then it would be added in. That would be the big thing.
Okay, so it's so I'm not sure I'm in this particular county. Depending on the, okay, Yeah. These are GIS, okay, that's a project, but, you know, I'm not familiar with how the club structure is, you know, so if they're project-based clubs, then that's okay. You still want to make sure that with the GIS club, you know, if we need to add a project listing to cover that, that's fine. But there should be something checked for these clubs. And if the clubs have different names, but this was a way of organizing the different projects, then that's something that we can fix too. So then, let's see here. Home screen. Do you guys have a home screen on your County View when you log in? You should be able to at least view a snapshot screen like this.
I believe so.
Right? Okay. So on your snapshot screen, So what you'll see here, your new messages, those are email alerts, like if you had an initial enrollment or initial event registration. You guys aren't doing events at this point, but so your announcements and newsletters show here. It's showing you that you have two pending enrollments. And then it also gives you a quick enrollment snapshot. And those are pretty nice. You get community members a call or ask or kind of curious about where your youth program is at. You can go on right on your home screen and look at that. Your announcements and newsletters, it's very easy to post those. I recommend uploading PDF documents. So for events, Idaho uses event registration. We also use Marketplace for teen conference for non-4-H participants. But event registration is one of those other features that's available on the universal license.
So just to let you, so we do, the university has us using Eventbrite for event registration, but that is a conversation that we need to talk about because I don't know if they've ever been introduced that 4-H Online has that option. The only problem we'd have is with payment. We'd have to figure out how to do that, but.
Did you guys take credit cards?
And I would ask the counties. So I'm thinking like Sam and Karen are probably the two that know that.
We're working with the university. We're on probably year two for our credit card. Okay, so you guys use credit cards. So the caveat to processing credit cards through 4-H Online really depends on your payment gateway, I think. I don't, that might be the wrong word. But TouchNet has been added as an approved payment gateway or payment provider processor, which is why the University of Idaho is even engaging in this process, because that is the same platform, if you will, for what we use in Marketplace. We already have a contract with TouchNet, and that kind of cut a fraction of the red tape that Shannon and I had to wade through. they have another one too, and that's escaping me at the moment. But you can still do events if you can't get the credit card piece taken care of in 4-H Online. But if you have credit cards through Eventbrite, you may want to see what your university will come back with as far as your payment gateway. The nice thing about the events, though, I have to say, and something to think about, is that you basically can take your registration form and whittle it down to a fraction of the packets that you used to have to create. And the reason why I say that is everything from 4-H Online feeds into your events. And I'm talking all of your member information, their address, their emergency information. We do a health form, so all of that, all of your media consent, we have in our enrollment piece. We do ask t-shirt sizes, all of that carries forward. So you're not having to recreate, reinvent, or ask the same questions you primarily ask on your enrollment paperwork. Also, we have code of conduct that we capture at enrollment that carries forward. So when you get into your event registrations, you're asking event-specific questions. You can discern, okay, what are the amount of monies that somebody is going to have to pay? You have the ability to set your different clearances. So for a district event, you can have counties approve a registration, and you can also have the district coordinator, whoever your point person is for that event, pipeline into that. For state level events, kind of the same deal. We have a variety of structures for our state events where we have to have all three levels because everything has to kind of marry up at the county level. The event I'm talking about is KYG, so our NORI Government Conference. So at the county level, we have X amount of spots. Counties have to approve this registration. Districts should have a name list of who should be coming from these counties. They approve. Part of their approval process is paperwork, payment, those types of things. When it comes to state level, then that's pretty much telling me, okay, this is good to go. Yes, it is a huge time saver. And one of the things we're working on is archery events. We've had statewide archery contests. They've run their registration through Excel last few years. Come time to do the shoot, and we've discovered that we've had a couple members register for a state shoot, and they're not active 4-H members. So the caveat to being able to register for an event in 4-H Online is you have to have an active profile. What that means is that your enrollment has been set or approved in the system. So for the youth, they're enrolled, they're active, their information is current. For adults, especially for your chaperones, they've passed their screening, they've done all of their recertification stuff. If they're active, they're golden. If not, then they can't do that. You cannot register for an event, and there's criteria you can set for your event, be it a project-based. So if they have to be enrolled in that project for that to show on their screen, or if it's for a certain age range or from certain counties, and you can kind of hear where I'm going with this, there's a lot of different parameters you can set on your events. The key piece is they have to be active. So if they're not active, maybe they hit the other parameters, then they can't do it. So it saves a lot of loopholes.
And if you do have, because we, you know, I'm thinking like in our urban areas, we do have some non-4-H'ers that may participate in some of our events, but there's ways that you can work around that.
Yes, absolutely.
So just so everybody is aware, you know, I'm thinking of camps as a big one. You know, I think in Las Vegas and probably here in, you know, probably all over, we may get a number of kids that aren't necessarily club members, but we can figure out how to work through that system.
So what we've done for like teen conference, so this is the event we do on campus. We have large 4-H population that participates in that. We also have several non-4-H, even out-of-state members that come and engage in our conference. So if you have something similar to Marketplace, you can do that. You can facilitate that registration process, especially if you're going to have a large number. You want to have something electronic to help facilitate that. If you're talking about a small number, make a packet, you know, have them come to the office, and you process it that way and just make sure your headcounts match. But there are ways to facilitate that for sure.
When Erica is talking about Marketplace, that would be like our Eventbrite.
Yeah.
So
something through your university where you can basically put in the different elements of your event, capture the essential pieces of information. You may have to mail a packet, if you will, to that member, or have them come in and fill out some information, you know, so you have your contact information, you're getting consent for treatment, if there's an emergency, that type of thing. But that workaround saves a lot of time, for sure. The beauty about also 4-H events, you can export any, your reports kind of link in, but you can combine your enrollment pieces to your event registration pieces, so you can generate event-specific reports, if you will. So I usually do a health detail report, an allergy report. I get a roster, head counts. There's a lot of different things you can do in that, and you can export any of those reports into PDF format or Excel, just like you would with any of the other reports that are in right now in your standard report. So it's definitely something to think about. I think events, you have to have events on the universal license. So I'm not sure, Carrie, if I'm seeing the events tab. So that makes me wonder why you're not having the animals tab, and maybe that's still in test mode. But if you have the events tab, then then you should be able to do that.
And I'm still trying to figure out from James what all we have and don't have.
Okay. All right. Well, so your events, you basically set them up and do all your confirmation right off the events tab. And I don't want to get into that one, that component just yet. Are there any questions on what I've covered so far on the general, you know, bare bones pieces on this? Were there some things you wanted to see, like in standard reports, or what you have right now? Because I can get into bells and whistles, and I can kind of show you some different things that we've done with animals, and then show events and give you a little sneak peek of what that looks like on the Idaho side.
You can either type in the chat box or you can unmute and talk.
Okay, well.
I know personally I'm kind of, you know, so new to this that it's like valuable information, but it's hard to wrap my brain around it because I don't have the foundation that comes before that.
Stormy got access to 4-H online yesterday, so.
Holy shnikes. Okay. I'm sorry. So. That's brutal. Well, so one website, I'm going to copy and paste this into the chat box.
And this is also linked for everybody on our, so I think most everybody knows where it is, but if you go to the employees only page on the extension website, there we have a 4-H help page, or a 4-H online help page, and we do have a link to the Idaho page. So just so everybody's aware, because, you know, again, trying to figure out how to help you guys. But so that link is there, but then Erica did just share that link.
So there's a couple different things you can root around on here. Like I said, there's no such thing as a bad question. So for those of you guys so new to this right now, I apologize for overwhelming y'all, but probably got the wheel spinning, so that's okay.
And we've got a variety. We have brand new, and we have people that have been using it since the beginning.
Okay. So. Well, this is a great place to kind of wander and meander around. It's still live. I am in the process of changing that over to Sitecore. That process is going to take some time. So that is I'm keeping this link as live as I possibly can. Our university is really on the fast track of getting rid of these WordPress pages, but I've been adamant, you can't do it until I tell you. You cannot make this page go away, please. I am gonna be updating the instructional manual, but it does have components in there. It needs some massaging for sure. But I do have tip sheets. And so it basically breaks it down. I have enrollment, data management. I talked about earlier project completion, how you can print labels. Also, now I've had hit and miss success with the club meeting attendance. I don't know if this is fully functional or not. I want it to be, but I apologize if this isn't quite working in the system yet. But some different components, your risk management, how to do your reports, some components about animal entry. We have a friends tab, and I think that's also available in Universal License Carry for friends, which includes FFA and judges. So you have the ability to make a judge's repository. That hasn't been as widely popular in Idaho as I thought it would be, just because the judges are, you know, you kind of hold them to your vest. You don't want to share those names because if you have fares that overlap, then you run the risk of losing your judge. I totally get that. But not having to have everything in a paper-based or Excel format, that works too. FFA though, I don't know if you guys have FFA chapters. This is something where if you're having to facilitate your weigh-ins and you have kind of marginal success in communication with your FFA advisors, this may be something Carrie wants to look at turning on for you guys. It doesn't give them access to 4-H online. You have to kind of manage that, but at least if you can get what species, what name, emergency information from the FFA advisors, then you can basically build a one-stop shopping list so you know definitively who's going to be coming in to weigh-ins. That was the and if that's all you accomplish with that, that's great. But there are ways where you can at least build your reports where you get your FFA members pipelined into there. So it gives you an accurate picture when it comes time to setting up your classes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You have that information. Something to think about. Little tip sheets on sending your communications. Different leader training pieces, your year-end rollover components, and last but not least, the reporting. So we have a reporting guideline piece. We have to update that periodically as our programming changes and stuff, but it does give you different guidelines as far as, okay, this is what I'm doing. How do I report that? Should I report that? So there's a lot of information in here. Also on this page, I do a monthly session called Cafe 42 with Idaho folks. I record all these sessions. You're always welcome to attend, and I should just put a link into there, but basically it gives you, I keep a record of the chat log, but I also got the video. So I kind of do an hour session, walk through that type of thing, but if you're interested in kind of viewing what has gone, what I've talked about and that type of thing, you're more than welcome to that information as well. So a couple things for Idaho.
Erica, just really quick, Karen just asked the question about, she said it's a little off topic, but I think it's, she asked, how do we see the system from the main leader's point of view?
Oh, and sure.
So if you can show them how to do that.
Yeah. So the family leader view in the system is definitely different. How leaders access the system is basically they have a member profile. But when they log into the system, after they've entered in their password, this is what they'll see. And this is kind of the same screenshot what you have for families. you have a demo county, I recommend creating an alter person of yourself just to get an experience of what it is that your families are going to see when they log in the system. And if you're doing paper-based enrollments, this may not be as important for you to do that. But if you have families that are logging in, take some time, create a record, and familiarize yourself with that. The demo county is the place to do that. In Idaho, you will see our staff and myself. I do have leader profiles, but I'm tied in with different projects, and so I do have an active account. But when they click log in, again, your announcements and newsletters show right there, so this is another reason why you want to put content in the system. And then they can select from this drop-down menu their club leader or project leader login. So there's a couple different things that you have to do on your end to set that up. But let's see here. I can't click continue to family, but if there should be an orange button here. We've locked out folks in Bonner County because there were some new profiles being created. We're not ready for the new 4-H year. So, but what will happen is once they click log in to their family, they'll see their member list. And so then from there, they'll have an adult profile. But as far as logging into the system and doing volunteer management, if you will, for the clubs, etc., let me go into a county and kind of show you what you need to do that setup. So there's a couple different things. You have to basically provide login access for your club leaders and then also for your project leaders. It's not one, just one click and it does it all. So for your club leaders, my system is being slow today. For your club leaders, you want to click on your clubs. And then from your drop-down list, you want to, find your club that you're wanting to work through, or you might go through all of your clubs. But under here, once you have your enrollments in, under here you should see a list of all your volunteers. Caveat for this is they have your adults who are volunteering need to mark the box that they are a volunteer. They don't. And if they don't, then they will never be able to get to this next level. Their names will not show on this list. So that's a data piece of cleaning house that would be helpful. They are volunteering. I don't know why that question is in there, but we can't get rid of it. But the green V is absolutely paramount for them to even get into this part. But you have to go through and check the box allow login. So basically, if you allow them login, then they will be able to use that club password and then they'll be able to log in. And then they should have their, what their type is. If you know your organizational leader is showing up as a project leader, by all means, change that too. They don't necessarily get into the title, but it's important that they're identified appropriately in the system as an organizational leader. And they may be the only ones that you want to have allowed to log in. So once you check allow login, they can access, they can pull reports, they can see who's in their club. Member management, we don't have a lot of clubs using that. And the reason being is that they can change member information. That's the exception, not the rule, as far as folks who are allowed that level of management into their club. And then the system will create automatically a ridiculous password, all sorts of things that are very confusing for folks to remember. The nice thing about that is you can set a new club password. And it works really well just to do something very simple, even the club name with a numeric number, all lowercase. So then that way, it's something that is easy for them to remember. If you need to reset it, it's not a big deal, but it's much better than the system-generated club passwords. Now, to allow login access for your project leaders, you have to go to the Options tab, and you'll have under the dashboard, there's a gray line here. Click Project Leaders, and then from here, you'll see all of the projects. One of the things that I've asked for several times from James is the ability to filter it by name. We don't have that option. And I don't have the ability to email all of these. Every project that you have in the system has its own specific password. Your project passwords are first three characters are numeric. The last three characters are capitalized alpha. So if you have a leader that's involved in everything under the sun, this gets to be a very tedious process. And I apologize for that. There's no quick and easy way of aligning somebody's name and all of their project passwords and copying and pasting it and dumping it into an email. Oh no, that would just be too simple. But you have to scroll through the projects, and we don't have the ability. They're alphabetized now. We don't even have a way of filtering that. But you have to scroll through, find the person's name, find their project, click the allow login. Now, if you do countywide projects, you're going to want to do this. And what I mean by that is if you have just a countywide beef project, you're going to have kids from several questions or several clubs coming into this project, you're going to want to do countywide. You're not going to be able to see them if it's just allow login, because the login in this, the way it's marked right now, the only people that Kendra is going to see are Carrie Wood Eager Beavers. That's it. So you work through that whole list. So I got to look and see on mine. What clubs am I in? I forget. Trailblazers. No. Okay. I gotta do a little digging in the system. Okay, so Trailblazers. And then
we have about 6 minutes, Erica. Just okay.
Let me hop into Boundary County. So once you log in, clubs. So project leaders do not get as much detail as club leaders. Your club leaders, and for whatever reason, the password populates, but it's not the right one. So if they've been granted access, can log in. They can log in, and what they're going to see is they'll have a search screen. They can see who their members are, if they're active. They get a lot of different filters. They can confirm their members. This does not override or supersede your county approval. The members gives them the full roster, and then you can click and do an email list. And the nice thing about reports is they get access to the standard reports on the club level, any of their fair registration information. If they need a re-enrollment form, if you need any of the authorizations, and you can also create shared reports. So if there's something specific that you want all of your leaders to see, then now they'll get that report. On your project leader login, what they get is very, very minimal, but they too can still get a list. And there is anybody in there, but it basically just get their member information, so their name, member and number, their status, family information, and then club, and then you get a couple quick options as far as labels and creating a list. And it's basically a one screen deal, but that is their views. The nice thing about that is if you get a lot of phone calls for people wanting club lists and that type of thing, this gives them the ability to log in their computer. They get it one-stop shopping. You can, for the most part, pull up 4-H Online on any of your handheld devices. The caveat is if you're trying to run reports, it doesn't work so well. But as far as basic login and pulling up quick information, if they're needing a phone number, that type of thing, it's all right there. So it is available. I kind of went through things, you know, real quick, but I guess since we're getting close on time, I can't really delve into the nitty gritty on animals and events, but those are definitely some things we could go into on the next session.
Anybody else have any other questions? The other thing I'm going to let people know too is Erica and I are actually staying on the line because we started what's called the Zen Desk. And so that's going to be a chance when you guys have questions that come up during the week. If it's something simple, hopefully I can help you with it. But if it's not, then what we can do, and it's not an emergency that you get it taken care of right then you would submit a ticket per se into Zendesk, and that will send an email to both Erica and myself with questions that you have, and then that way on these sessions those can be identified, and Erica can show us how to do that. And so we'll be I've got it started. I just don't know how to use it, and so I'm gonna have her show me how to use that and get that set up for you guys.
No problem. Like I said, there's no such thing as a back question, and I'm happy to help you guys out and get this rolling for y'all.
Yes. They've been most of our counties have been using it about 3 or 4 years. It's just we're still trying to move forward. I'm trying to show them some of the other features that we have too available. So thank you.
Yeah, and I guess something we need to have a visit with James about is delineating, okay, yes, do we truly have a universal license, or what's turned on, or what's on test mode?
Yep.
Because your guys' tabs are way different than what we have. That's all right. We'll get it sorted out.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Yep. And I will send out the